Hello and welcome to a new video on the Crypto2 YouTube channel. In this video, I want to talk about passwords. I structured this video into different parts. In the first part, I want to give you a definition and usage of passwords. Then I want to show you how passwords are stored. After that, I want to show you how passwords are attacked. And finally, I want to show you how you can create strong passwords. As with every video in the Basics of Cryptology series, I first show you where we are in this tree here. And we are currently in cryptology, cryptography, modern cryptography. A password is a secret word or phrase. A password historically comes from the military. And a password was needed, for instance, to pass the entrance of a secured area, for instance, a barrack or a castle. Of course, in this video, we speak about computer systems. And in a computer system, a password usually gives access to a secured area of that system. Passwords started with login to multi-user systems. And the password is used for authentication, and the access is the authorization. And we know different types of computer passwords. For instance, we have a shared password, which is shared by a group of users. Then we have a personal password that's only known by a single user. And of course, we have the one-time password, which is only valid for one-time usage. You probably know one-time passwords when you registered at a website and then they send you an email and you have, for instance, to enter a one-time password in the webpage to finish the registration. Let's speak about password storage. And since 1975, passwords are not stored as plain text anymore. And passwords are cryptographically hashed and then the hash value is stored. If you are familiar with Linux or Unix, you probably know the etc password file or the etc shadow file. If you don't know what a cryptographical hash is, you should have a look at the previous video where I give you an introduction to cryptographic hash functions. And cryptographic hash functions are one-way functions, which are also pre-image resistant. That means given an x1 and a hash of x1, and for instance that x1 is a password, it's hard to find any x2 for which the hash of x2 equals to the hash of x1. So it's difficult to find another password, or it's even difficult to find the original password when it's hashed. Of course, this is only true for secure passwords. What a secure password is, we will see on the next slides. And for authentication, the hash value of the given password is compared to the stored hash value. And if both hash values are equal, the user gets access. And there are some problems with the approach, only using a pure hash value, as shown here. And what these problems are, you will see on the next slides. I created here two pictures to show you how password storage and password verification works. And for instance, the password storage is done during the registration or the user account creation. And the password is given to the cryptographic hash function, and the hash value, in this case H1, is then stored in the password database, for instance a MySQL server or the etc password or etc shadow. And then later, when you want to log in a system, you of course need password verification. So you enter the password, the entered password is given to the same cryptographic hash function, you get a hash 2. Then of course the hash of the user's account is loaded from the database, and if the loaded hash and the given hash are equal, the system gives you access, and of course if they are not equal, the system rejects the access. Let's now speak about how passwords are attacked. And before we speak about some attacks, we have to think of an attacker model. And I have here in my attacker model two attackers. First, we have an external attacker. That's someone coming from the outside of a system or network, for instance, a hacker. And then, of course, there can be internal attackers. And an internal attacker is already inside the system, for instance, an administrator or another user in the same system. Now let's have a look at some attacks. And you see here the green color and the red color. The green color here means a good password can protect us against this attack. And the red color means that even a good password cannot protect us against this attack. And the first attack we have is the capture of an unencrypted password. And of course, when an attacker captures an unencrypted plaintext password, he can just read the password and then he has it. So it even having a good password does not protect us against such an attack. But of course, systems that send unencrypted plaintext passwords, for instance, through the network are really badly designed systems. And today, every good system should encrypt passwords and hash passwords. Another attack we have is that the attacker could capture the hash value of a password. And of course, a good password protects us against this because then the attacker cannot find the pre-image when it's a good password. Then we have another attack. For instance, the attacker could copy the password database and the passwords are stored as plain text. That's the same as a password going over the network that is unencrypted. Of course, then your password is known by the attacker. Otherwise, the attacker could copy a password database and the passwords are stored as hash values in the database. In that case, a good password can protect you against such an attack. Then there's another attack where the attacker tries to log into a system using different passwords. So he brute forces the login of a system. And good systems, of course, forbid this. For instance, when you enter 3 times the wrong password, you cannot enter it for 5 minutes or so, and then brute force attack is really hard. But if we have an account in a badly designed system where this is possible, also a good password protects us because the attacker will never find a good password at login. And then, of course, we have the 2 last attacks here. The attacker could install a keylogger on your system. Then, even when you have a good password, the attacker logs the good password and knows it. Or he even could read the password directly from the memory. Then, of course, also a good password cannot protect us. And in general, if an attacker has, for instance, root access to our system, he can do everything of these attacks. And, of course, then even a good password cannot protect us. Now let's have a look at some attacks on hash values or hashed passwords. And for the rest of part 8.1.3, we assume that the password is hashed and the attacker has the hash value. And the first attack we have is the brute force attack, also known as exhaustive search through the password space. And with a brute force attack, the attacker tries all passwords with length 1, length 2, length 3, up to a specified length, for instance, n. And he uses as different characters at each position of the password. And it's not hard to compute the attack complexity of such an attack. So we have s to the power of 1 passwords of length 1, s to the power of 2 passwords of length 2, s to the power of 3 passwords of length 3, and so on and so on and so on, and s to the power of n passwords of length n. And of course, when we want to search through all of these, we have to add the numbers of these passwords, and this is the total number of passwords an attacker has to test. And I have here an example with uppercase, lowercase letters, digits, and special characters. We have 95 symbols, and I computed here the time that an attacker needs to break these passwords using brute force. And here we have a powerful attacker who is able to test 100 billion hash values per second. And as you can see, up to length 7 here, it only takes a few minutes to break these passwords. So in these 11 minutes, the attacker is able to search through the complete search space or password space. Of course, on average, he only has to search half of the space. So he will find your password probably not in 11 minutes, but between 5 and 6 minutes on average. And then even with a password of length 8, it only takes him 70 hours to search through all of the possible passwords. And as you can see, when you increase the size here with 9 letters, it already takes the attacker 673 days, with 10 letters, 176 years, and after 10 letters, so with 11 letters or more, it's over 1,500 years. So a good password should have a minimum length of 10 here. Now let's speak about the next attack on passwords, and that is the dictionary attack. And the dictionary attack is an intelligent search through the password space. And instead of testing all possible passwords, an attacker has a dictionary of commonly used passwords. For instance, let's assume he has the 1 million most common passwords. So the total search time is then only 1 millisecond. And clearly, if the password is not in the dictionary, the attack fails. But people tend to use such easy passwords that are also part of dictionaries. And we found out that about 80% of all passwords can be broken this way. And even worse, really good password crackers, for instance John the Ripper, which is the state of the art of password crackers, can use rules to adapt the stored password. Let's assume our password is something like password and we replaced the O with a zero. And John the Ripper, for instance, has these rule sets where it, for instance, appends a digit at the beginning here or at the end here. He uses uppercase letters or even the complete word uppercase, camel case, and he even changes some characters, for instance, the D to the T. And so he makes smart changes to the password. And people try also this. Maybe you did this by yourself. You have a word and then put a number at the end. So John the Ripper will find this, of course. So it's not a good idea to have a password that is part of a dictionary or which is close to a word in a dictionary. Then we have our third attack with rainbow tables. And with a rainbow table, you can perform an optimized search through this password space. And rainbow tables are pre-constructed to speed up the search for a hash pre-image, in our case, a password. And cryptographers speak of time-memory trade-offs, so time is substituted by memory. And of course, the rainbow table is only effective on passwords without a salt. What a salt is, I will show you later. And rainbow tables, or the details of rainbow tables, are not part of this video. Maybe in the future I will make a video specific to rainbow tables. So now let's talk about salt. A salt protects us against rainbow tables. What does this mean? Instead of storing the password's hash, the value hash of the password and the salt is stored. And what is the salt? The salt is a randomly chosen non-secret bit string which is stored in parallel to the hash. So you have the hash value in your password database and then you have another value which is the salt. And when you want to compute the hash of the given password, you take the password that the user gives you, you take the salt of the that is stored in the database, you compute this, and then you compare this with the hash value. When you want to attack a password with a rainbow table that has a salt, you need the specific rainbow table with such salt value that you also computed when you created the rainbow table. Of course, you would have to create a rainbow table for every possible salt, and this is impractical. Then we have Pepper, and Pepper protects us against stealing the password database. That is more or less to secure the data or the hash values in the database additionally. And the Pepper is added to the password and the salt. So we have the hash of the password plus the salt plus the Pepper. And the Pepper is stored outside the database. The Pepper is also a randomly chosen bit string. And of course, if only the database is stolen, the Pepper is still unknown, so the attacker cannot even compute anything using the Pepper. And of course, then we have finally repeated hashing, which increases the attack time per hash. So instead of storing the hash of a password in the database, we hash the password, and then we hash the hash, and we hash the hash, and we hash the hash, and so on. And we do this so many times that this operation, for instance, takes half a second. Every time a user logs into the system needs half a second to check if the password is correct. For the user, this is okay. But if you want to attack such hash values, testing every hash value takes you half a second, then testing 1 million passwords, you need half a million seconds. So this also makes attacks on passwords really hard or even impossible. Now let's speak about how to create strong passwords and have some ideas and rules. And the first most important rule, I think, is that you should never trust any system. Therefore, you should use a different password for every system. And why do we do this? Of course, if one password is compromised, so there's only one system, you use the same password with every system, and there's only one system where the attacker was able to get even your clear text password, then of course the attacker can use this in every other system. But if you have different passwords with different systems, the attacker is only able to log into that one system, but not in all the other systems. Then some other ideas, for instance, a password should protect us against brute force attack, dictionary attack, and rainbow tables. So how do we do this? First of all, don't use a password that is written in a dictionary. That helps us against a dictionary attack. And of course, also don't use passwords that are very similar to a password written in a dictionary. So this secures us against dictionary attacks. Then the password has to be complex. We have lowercase, uppercase, digits, and special characters. And this helps us against brute force attacks. But what helps us even more is instead or additional to complexity, a password should be very long. For instance, we have here a password that is this is a very, then we have a special character, then we have a digit, secure password, and an 8. This password is 28 characters long. No attacker will ever try to find this. When an attacker attacks a password database, he usually uses such tools like John the Ripper and tests every password in the database. And of course, the very weak passwords will fall. And you can assume that when the attacker found about 70 or 80% of all passwords in the database, he will stop his attack and he has enough logins or passwords that he can use. And this password he will not find because even John the Ripper won't come so far to test this year. And of course, this password here can be remembered more easily than a more complex random one. And the best idea to have secure passwords is that you use a local password safe, for example, KeyPass, which is an application where you can generate random passwords and also store these encrypted. And you only need to choose one very strong master password to log into KeyPass. And all other passwords then, as I already said, are long random passwords. For instance, 32 characters stored in that password safe. And when you want to log in a web page, you go to KeyPass, you enter your master password, you copy the password for the website you want to log in. Yeah, and that's it. And even when the hash value of your password of that website is stolen, since it's a 32 characters long random password, the attacker will never find this password. And even if he would find it, since you use different passwords for every web page, he can only use this in the web page he attacked. And another tip I want to give you, if you want to check if one of your accounts is already compromised, there's this haveibeenpwned.com website here, and you should go to this. There you can enter your email address, and then you will see, for instance, when there was a big password leak of a web page and your password also leaked, then you will see this on this site. So this site is very good to find out if your account is compromised. And now I want to show you what we have implemented with passwords in CrypTool2, and I also show you passwords in CrypTool-Online. First, I want to show you what you can do with passwords on the CrypTool-Online webpage. And I'm here now on CrypTool-Online. And when you want to go to the passwords, you go to highlights, and then for instance, to the password generator. And the password generator is a nice tool where you can generate random passwords. And KeyPass, for instance, would also generate such passwords here. Let's generate a 32 characters long password, and we want to have lowercase characters, uppercase characters, numbers, and special characters. And then you'd click on generate password, and then you get a 32 characters long random password. And of course, these passwords here are not stored on our webpage, so you could use this password, for instance, as a login to a webpage. And then we have a really nice other site on CrypTool-Online that deals with passwords. So you go to highlights, and then you go to password meter. And then you have this page here. And in the password meter, you can enter your password. And of course, we also do not store this password here. So let's enter a password. And as you can see here, while I enter the password here in the text input field, you see some ratings. And this, for instance, is a rating that is implemented in KeyPass. Then you have a rating from Mozilla, from PGP, from ZXCVBN, StatsPS, and Total. And you see how these organizations or tools or rating algorithms rate your password. And when you, of course, increase the complexity of your password, these values also increase. So this is also a good way to rate if you use a strong password. Now let's have a look at passwords in CrypTool-2. I'm here now in CrypTool-2 and I want to show you what we have implemented with passwords. And in the template section, I search for password. And then we have password store using Soltis SHA-1. And of course, if you have seen my last video, you should know that SHA-1 should never be used for any serious purposes since it's broken. But as an example, we can use this here. And what do we have here? You can enter here a password. Then there's the salt value. You should change this to 4-byte. Then the salt is appended to the password. Then the hash value is computed. Then also the salt is appended. Then the base 64 value of these is computed. Then we have a prefix. And in the end, we get a string here that looks like this. And then you can enter here your password, for instance, password. And every time we change this here, so I, for instance, enter again password, then you see that this value here also changes since the salt is a random value. And let's copy this. This is what is stored on the server. Then we go to the start center and search for password verification using salted SHA-1. And in this template, we can add our stored hash value. And then we can check our password by clicking here on play. And you see 123 is wrong. But when you enter password, you see it's the same password. This workspace also computes the hash value of that password using the same salt and then compares these. And if the passwords are the same, it gives you a green light. We have also some templates with Blake and Grostel with passwords, but I also want to show you a dictionary attack on a password hash. In this template here, you can enter a hash value of a password and then you can attack these. So with a dictionary, the workspace here is searching through that dictionary, computes a hash value of all words in the dictionary, and then when it finds the same hash, it tells you that this was the original password. You may also have seen this in the video about hash functions, and in this video I want to attack a different hash value. So I go to the start center, go to SHA. First I have to look which hash function is used here. So we have SHA-256 here. So we go to SHA-1, change this here to SHA-256, and our password is password. Click on play, then we have this hash value here as hex values. We go to the dictionary attack, and we can change the test password here. And then we click on play. As you can see, the dictionary attack here tests every word of the dictionary. It computes the hash value. You can see the hash values here when you mouse over the output here. And you see this takes a lot of time. CrypTool-2 is not very fast with this dictionary attack, but you can speed this up by closing this text output, because the text outputs here slow the attack down. When you close this here, you will see that the attack gets a lot of faster. And as you can see here, CrypTool-2 found the password. And it tested all the passwords of the dictionary until it found the password. And so you see, this is why you should never use a password that is part of a dictionary. And this is everything that I wanted to show you in this short video about passwords. I hope you liked the video. If yes, give a thumbs up. If no, you know what to do, give a thumbs down. And if you did not yet subscribe to our channel, I would be really happy if you do so. This really helps us to grow the channel and makes CrypTool-2 more popular. So thank you very much for watching and see you in the next video.